250 in your hymnal, 250. There's within my heart a melody. Jesus whispers sweet and low. Let's all stand together as we sing 250. There's within my heart a melody. Jesus whispers sweet and low. Fear not, I am with thee. Peace be still in a love like that.
Singing this morning, and welcome to the morning service. Looking forward to a great service together here this morning. Thanks for getting up and being in your place today for church. First Sunday of June. How about that? And how many of you are out of school now? Kids, out of school? Done? Good. All right. Amen. The teachers too. Yeah, we're out. Good for you, and looking forward to a great summer. It's going to be a great time here at Bible Baptist Church. And let's open the service with a word of prayer, shall we? Father, we thank you for another opportunity and another Lord's Day to come together. There is something different in the air when it's Sunday. Lord, we are excited to be here today. We're looking forward to what you have in store for us in the service this morning. And Lord, right now we bow before you and ask you to speak to our hearts and minister to us as only you can. We want you to, Lord. We invite you to do a work in each of our hearts and our lives. Draw us closer to you because we're here today, and make us more like Christ because we gathered together in church this morning. Bless the music, bless our fellowship together, the giving of the tithes and the offerings, and Lord, the honor again and use the preaching of the Word of God in each one of our hearts and lives. And I pray and ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, you may be seated.
I came to the Lord with my heart full of sin, empty of purpose and troubled within. My flesh had the victory, my heart sought release. Lord, wilt thou cleanse me and grant me thy peace? Create in me a clean heart, my Father, renew a right spirit in me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation. Make I pray. He granted cleansing and sins fell away. My bondage was ended, my heart was set free. Lord, nevermore may I wander from Thee. Create in me a clean heart, my Father, renew a right spirit in me. Restore unto me the joy of Thy salvation. May Christ be seen in me. When the world looks at me, do they see Jesus? When the world looks at me, what do they see? Do they see hope? Do they see love? Do they see charity? When the world looks at me, what do they see? May Christ be seen in me.
Amen. Number 46 in your hymnal, 4-6. When I see the blood, I will pass. I will pass over you. 46. Let's sing that first, second, and last stanza together.
Christ our Redeemer died on the cross. Died for the sinner, paid all his due. Sprinkle your soul with the blood of the Lamb, and I will pass over you. When I see the blood, when I see the blood, when I see the blood, I will pass.
Listen carefully now, a few announcements for us. Our schedule today, 5:30 for our Christian growth class. That meets in the conference room right down across from our nursery. 5:30, it's open to anyone who wants to grow a little bit in their Christian life, but especially if you're a new Christian, you want to be in those classes. And tonight's lesson is on prayer. If there's one area of any Christian's life that they feel like they could improve upon, it would be their prayer life and their prayer time with God. And so we'll discuss prayer this evening and what prayer is and how to be effective in our prayers to God. That'll be the 5:30 class this evening. Then 6:30, we'll be back here for the evening service right here in the auditorium. And tonight, we'll, Lord willing, going to speak on perfect Christianity, all right? And find out what that's all about this evening. And right after the service tonight, we'll have a fellowship time. The teens will be having their final fundraiser. We leave Friday for our mission trip to Mexico, and there's a total of 23 from our church leaving and going. So it is imperative that all of you who are here be here next Sunday, okay? Because 23 of us are going to be gone, and that's quite a hole in the church. And so I want you to be here. We have Pastor Tim Knipp coming. Pastor Nip is from Lancaster Baptist Church, and you'll enjoy Pastor Nip, and you don't miss out on that next Sunday, okay? So I could have you raise your right hand and read after me and all that stuff, but I'll just trust that you'll be in your place next Sunday, all right? And have a great, great service together while we're in El Paso and preparing to go to Mexico on our missions trip. And we sure appreciate you praying for those of us going on the missions trip, all right? But that fundraiser will be tonight, the final one for our teens. They have some nachos and cheese and some coney dogs, and there'll be things to drink, and there's going to be some sweets, and it's going to be a great time. So plan on staying. Our missionaries tonight, missionaries to Oaxaca, Mexico, Joe and Amy Hendricksman will be in our service tonight. They're flying out tomorrow from Columbus to Oaxaca on a trip down there. They'll be there for several weeks, and so they're going to get to be with us tonight in our service. So it's going to be a great time. Plan on being back tonight for our fellowship, and we appreciate those of you who have helped. We've had several special gifts come in for those to help people go to Mexico. That's been a great blessing. If you've not done so and you'd like to help somebody go, say, well, we can't go this year, but boy, we could put some money in. Some have put in several hundred dollars, others have put in just $50, but they put in something to help someone else to go, and that's an answer to prayer for them, because they're praying for God to supply, and you may be the answer to that prayer. So if God lays that on your heart to help, you can put that in the offering and just designate that part for Mexico, and we'll see to it that helps somebody on the trip, all right? Remember, ladies, your ladies' night out is tomorrow night. You're going miniature golfing, putt-putt golfing, and also getting some ice cream afterwards, and so it's going to be a fun night, and that can be for mothers, and you can bring your teenage daughters as well if you'd like, and just have a great night of it, and you'll have a good time. There is a sign-up sheet for that down on the table right at the bottom of the stairs, and if you'll sign up, that'll help us plan on how many ladies to expect tomorrow night. Also, the father-son barbecue coming up on the 18th. Sign-up sheet for that is down there as well, and you sign up for that. We'll have a great time together on the 18th. That's 5 o'clock at Windsor Park here in Grove City. Okay? I think that's all I've got right now. Let's take a moment and we'll welcome our guests that are with us in the service today. Anybody here today for the very first time in our church service, we want to meet you, find out who you are and where you're from, right back here, all right? Tell us who you are and where you're from. Griffin. Great. Good to have you this morning. Thank you. And who's with you today? Grandma. That's great. Do we call her Grandma, or does she have a name? Bev, all right. Good to have you folks from Grove City today. That's great. And Griffin here has been praying for our church, and we sure appreciate him doing that. And continue to pray for us. We appreciate you. Thank you. All right. Wrote me a letter and let us know what he's praying for, and that's wonderful. Thank you for being here this morning. That's great. Anybody else here for the very first time? All right. We welcome you. The usher is going to hand you a card to fill out, and when you get that card, if you'll take just a moment and fill that card out for us, we would appreciate it. We'll have a record of your visit with us this morning. In a little bit, we have the offering. If you'll just put that card in the offering, and then keep the pen as our gift to you for coming today. We're glad you're here. Let's give them a warm welcome, shall we?
57, number 57, years I spent in vanity and pride, caring not my Lord was crucified, knowing not it was for me he died on Calvary. 57, we're going to sing that first, third, and last together on that first. Years I spent in vanity and pride, caring not my Lord was crucified. On Calvary, mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty. At Calvary, now I've given to Jesus everything. Now I gladly own him as my king. Now my raptured soul can only sing of Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. Amen. Children, why don't you be dismissed to junior church? Children can be dismissed to junior church. Let's sing that last together. Oh, the love that drew salvation's plan. Oh, the love that drew salvation's plan. Oh, the grace. Oh, the mighty gulf that God did spend at Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. Amen. Great singing this morning. Let's turn over to 492, 492. Jesus Christ has made to me all I need, all I need. Would you stand with me as we sing 492 together on that first? Jesus Christ is made to me all I need, all I need. He alone is all my plea. He is all I need. Wisdom, righteousness, and power, holiness, this very and power, holiness, this very hour, my redemption full and free, he is all I need. Amen. Greet one another. Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guests. We'll come back and sing the last stanzas together. Thank you.
the treasure of my soul. All I need, all I need, he hath cleansed and made me whole. He is all I need. Wisdom, righteousness, and power, holiness, this very hour. My redemption full and free, he is all I need.
Jesus is my all in all. Would you sing that forth with me? All I need, all I need.
Jesus is my all in all. All I need, all I need. While he keeps, I cannot fall. He is all I need. Wisdom, righteousness, and power, holiness is very hard. My redemption full and free, he is all I need.
Let's sing that last stanza together. When we get to the chorus, we'll have the pianist drop out and we'll sing that a cappella. On that last together.
Glory, glory to the Lamb. All I need, all I need. By his Spirit sealed I am.
Singing, you may be seated. Ushers are coming. We'll get our offering today. Be ready to give as God has blessed and prospered you. And again, if you want to help somebody with Mexico, just put that down and put Mexico beside it, and we'll see to it that they get help with that. All right. Very good. We'll pray and we'll ask God's blessing on their offering this morning. Had a good morning out at London yesterday. Had 12 men there for the RU, one new fella, and things are going well there with the RU Inside program. And Brother Danny's one of the men who works out there, Danny Wright. I'm going to have him lead us in our prayer this morning for the offering.
Let's pray. Father, we thank you for another opportunity to gather here together in this place. Father, we need to hear from you today. We love you, Lord, and we need you. I just ask that you would go up and down every aisle, stop at every occupied seat. Father, we need to hear from you today. I pray that we can continue growing in our knowledge and understanding of who you are, that we not be timid or ashamed to tell people about you, Father, that we serve you faithfully and joyfully, and in all that we do, we exalt your name. I pray, Father, that each person in this room would build a personal, intimate, real, life-transforming relationship with you. They'd get the right people in their lives and the wrong people out. Be with the pastor as he opens up the only book you've ever written and teaches us about our Lord and Savior. And we'll thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please take your Bible this morning, if you would, please. Matthew chapter 8. Matthew chapter 8, please, for our scripture reading today. Matthew chapter 8, first book of the New Testament. Matthew 8. We're going to read the first four verses. I'm going to read verse 1, then you join me on verse 2, then I'll read 3, and we'll end together on verse 4, the first four verses of Matthew chapter 8. And as our custom is, let's stand together to read the scripture, all of us standing to read God's word, and I'll begin on verse 1. When he was come down from the mountain, great multitudes followed him. And behold, there came a leper and worshipped him, saying, Lord, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. And Jesus put forth his hand and touched him, saying, I will, be thou clean. And immediately his leprosy was cleansed. And Jesus said unto him, See thou tell no man, but go thy way, and show thyself to the priest, and offer the gift that Moses commanded for a testimony unto them. And let's pray together, shall we? Father, add your blessing, please, to the reading of the scripture here this morning. Lord, I pray that you will have our hearts ready and prepared to receive what you have for us today from your word. Now, we need your help, God. We need your help to help us put away from our minds thoughts that would capture our attention and keep us from hearing from you this morning. Keep us from concentrating and focusing on the message that you would have each of us to receive. And so, Lord, help us to be disciplined in our thinking and to the best of our ability, and with your help, give you our undivided attention as we come to the preaching of your word. Help us to listen carefully to the special as it's sung, and use the words and use this song to make our hearts ready to receive your word this morning. It's in Christ's name we ask it. Amen.
Across this land there rings a cry from broken hearts and tear-filled eyes, waiting for someone to come back home. It matters not who was to blame, there's just one way to remove the pain. Can't you hear their love now calling you? Come back home. Don't wait another day. No need to stay away, for home's where you belong. Can't you see
you see how much
Now, Heavenly Father, we bow before you in prayer as we come to the preaching of your word. And Lord, I pray for your help this morning as we bring the message. And I ask you, Lord, for help for each one of the people as they listen together this morning. Lord, I pray that each of us would quiet ourselves before you, that we'd hear the still small voice of the Holy Spirit. You'd minister to each one of us today as only you can. Give us ears to hear what the Spirit would say to his church this morning. Honor once again and bless the preaching of your word. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Matthew chapter 8. If you'd be kind enough to turn that bottom button on that fan there, would you please? Not the bottom one, the next one up. Right there. Perfect. Thank you. It was 1818, and in France, in Louis, a boy of 9, or as they might say, Louis, was sitting in his father's workshop. His father was a harness maker, and the boy loved to watch his father work the leather. "Someday, Father, I want to be a harness maker just like you." And his father said, "Why not start now?" He took a piece of leather and he drew a design on it. He said, "Now, my son, take the hole puncher and a hammer and follow this design, but be careful that you don't hit your hand." Excitedly, the boy began to work, but when he hit the hole puncher, it flew out of his hand and struck him in his eye. He lost sight of the eye immediately. Later, he lost sight in the other eye as well, and Lewis was now totally blind. A few years later, when he was sitting in the family garden, somebody handed him a pine cone. And as he ran his sensitive fingers over the pine cone, an idea came to him. And he got very excited and was very enthusiastic, and he began to create an alphabet with dots on paper so the blind could feel and interpret what was written. And thus Louis Braille opened up a whole new world for all who were blind, all because of an accident. You know, as he opens up a whole new world to those who are blind through the power of touch, scientists tell us that touch is one of the earliest senses to develop in the fetus and in the develop of infants as well. Touch can be a basic sense that each of us have not only just at the moment we're conceived. In fact, they even say, and you've seen in premature births, how vital it is that someone touch that child. Oftentimes they do so much better when just the mother is within touch of that newborn infant. When we care, we touch somebody. When we may squeeze an arm or touch their arm and let them know that we care. Sometimes people want to meet somebody great and they're excited to see someone who they greatly admire or someone who's well known throughout the country or the world, and maybe they get to shake their hand or they get to touch them in some way, and then somebody says, "Oh, he shook my hand or she shook my hand. I'll never wash that hand again." We know that wears off, don't we? We get over it, don't we? People do. But over and over and again, you find out in the New Testament, what was amazing about Jesus was he touched people. He was within reach of people. And can I tell you this morning, when Jesus touches you, you'll never be the same. When Jesus touches you, you'll never be the same. When he touches you, your life changes from that moment on. And we're going to look at some people that Jesus touched here in the New Testament. And we begin in Matthew chapter 8. The verses we just read this morning about a leper who Jesus touched. Notice it's the touch of salvation. It's the touch of salvation for this leper. When he was come down from the mountain, great multitudes followed him. By the way, that says a lot right there, does it not? You don't live the Christian life on the mountaintop. You have to live down where people live. Amen? That's how you touch people's lives. But wait, you touch people's lives by coming down from the mountain. But in order to touch people's lives, you must first have been on the mountain. You must have been where you met with God. That's where Jesus met with God. Oftentimes, you're reading the New Testament, how he departed himself into a mountain alone and he prayed there. That's where he prayed and met with God. You go to the mountaintop, and that is a mountaintop experience to meet with God and to talk with God, but you come down to touch people's lives. Amen? And so he came down, and there came a leper and worshipped him, saying, Lord, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. And Jesus put forth his hand and touched him, and saying, I will, be thou clean. And immediately his leprosy was cleansed. So he comes to Jesus, and the leper says, and by the way, that was an act of faith in itself. Most of you know, when they got leprosy in those days, they would be set apart from society. They would not be allowed to come near anyone. It was such a dreaded disease, and really a terminal disease, and it's such a easily spreadable disease that you didn't want to come in contact with anybody that had leprosy. And it's an amazing thing that when this man worships Jesus, and usually worship men, he came to him and fall down at his feet, that Jesus to him, I'm sure the amazement of everybody there, reached out and touched this leper. Man, that, you don't do that. What's he doing? You don't touch somebody that has leprosy. Now you're in trouble. And he was made sure he's in reach. And the great thing is, the leper asked Jesus, Will you heal me? Will you cleanse me? And you know the great thing is, Jesus is willing. He's willing. Yes, I am. Be thou clean, he said. And notice what the Bible says. Eventually the leprosy left him. Is that what it says? No, if your Bible says that, you got the wrong Bible. Okay? It doesn't say eventually, it says what? Immediately. Immediately he was cleansed. And I tell you this morning, you say, preacher, what does that have to do with us? I don't have leprosy. Oh, all of us do. Everybody in the room this morning has a disease that is very similar to leprosy. You know what it's called? It's called sin. And everybody, every one of us has that disease. And by the way, it's terminal. The end of sin is going to be death. Every one of us faces that at some point in our life, we're going to die. Why? Because the wages of sin is death. Sin, when it's finished, brings forth death. And so you're not going to get out alive. And listen, that's come some point in your life when you realize your condition. And you realize that I have a sin condition that cannot be cured. It doesn't matter how often I go to church. It doesn't matter how many prayers I pray. It doesn't matter how many good deeds I do. It doesn't matter how many commandments I try to perform. It doesn't matter how many verses I memorize. It doesn't matter how many church memberships I have. It doesn't matter how many Sunday school pins I wear. It doesn't matter how many times I get baptized. None of those things will cure my terminal disease. There's only one cure for that disease, and that is Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is the only one that can cure you of your terminal disease of sin. And the only thing that can take your sin away is Jesus Christ. I was just a young boy, but I realized my condition. And I got on my knees and someone opened the Bible and showed me that Jesus Christ died on the cross and paid for my sins when he died on the cross, that he was buried, that he rose again the third day, and that he's now willing to save all those who come unto God through him. And that if I'd call on the Lord Jesus and believe in mine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, that Christ died for me, and I would trust him as my Savior, that I shall be saved, that I would receive the gift of eternal life. And I prayed and asked Christ to save me, and immediately I received the gift of eternal life. Immediately I was passed from death unto life. Immediately my name was written down in heaven, and I received Christ, and I was saved. The songwriter said, shackled by a heavy burden, neath the load of sin and shame. Then the hand of Jesus touched me, and now I am no longer the same. Hey, has Jesus ever touched your life for salvation? Do you know that you have eternal life? Do you know? Hey, let me ask you a question. If you met this leper after Jesus had cleansed him, and now, hey, I don't know how advanced the leprosy was. I don't know if he had lost any fingers or lost any appendages, or it was things had turned black and weren't usable anymore. It was how obvious it was. We don't know that. But I know this, once he was cleansed, he knew it. Do you think he knew it? Think he got up and somebody said, "Hey, are you cleansed of your leprosy?" He said, "Well, I hope so." No, I don't think he said, "I hope so." "Yeah, you cleansed of your leprosy?" "Well, I think so." "Hey, are you cleansed from your leprosy?" "Well, I'm trying." No, he didn't say any of those. "Hey, I'm telling you what, brother, you saw that leper that day and you say, have you been cleansed from your leprosy?" He'd have said, "Hallelujah, I'm cleansed. I don't have leprosy anymore." And my friend, when you meet Jesus Christ and you trust Him as your personal Savior, my friend, when someone meets you and asks you, if you know, if you die, you'll go to heaven, are you sure that you have eternal life? My friend, it's not a maybe, it's not a hope so, it's not I'm trying, it is absolutely, I know Christ is my Savior, and I know I'm going to heaven. It's real. There's no doubt about it. He lives in my heart, and I'm going to shout it. I know my sins are forgiven, and I'm on my way to a place that's called heaven. He's touched me. Amen? Has Jesus touched you this morning? I'm not asking if you prayed a prayer one time and asked Jesus to save you. I'm not saying you walked an aisle sometime. I'm asking you, do you know Jesus has touched your life and given you eternal life? And you know that you're saved. But Jesus doesn't want to just touch your life for salvation. You're going to find as we go through the New Testament, Jesus wants to touch every area of our life. Every area of our life. Look a little bit further in Matthew 8, would you please? Drop down to verse number 14. The Bible says, when Jesus was coming to Peter's house, he saw his wife's mother laid sick of a fever. And he said, "That's too bad." No, he didn't. All right? Even though it was his mother-in-law. What did Jesus do? He touched her hand, and the fever left her. And she arose and ministered unto them. Hey, when he said she's sick of a fever, look what Jesus did. He touched her what? Touched her hand. And she immediately arose and served them, ministered or served them. Our hands represent what we do. Our hands represent what we do. How many of you in Sunday school when you were little used to sing, "Oh, be careful, little hands, what you do. Oh, be careful, little hands, what you do. For the Father up above is looking down in love. Oh, be careful, little hands, what you do." By the way, that's still a good truth to sing even if you're not in Sunday school. Amen? Being aware of what we do with our hands. You know, there's a lot of Christians, listen, there's people who've allowed Jesus to touch their life for salvation, but they stop there and they won't let Jesus touch their hands for what they do. They separate that out. Can I tell you, the hands that cradle wrong literature in their hand need Jesus to touch their hands? The hand that cradles a cigarette in their hand needs Jesus to touch their hands? The hand that would grip a bottle of alcohol in their hand needs Jesus to touch their hand. The hand that would make obscene gestures needs the touch of Jesus to touch their hand. The hand that can fit a bowling ball but not the steering wheel of a bus needs Jesus to touch their hand. The hand that can hold a movie ticket but not a gospel tract needs Jesus to touch their hand. The hand that can read the TV guide but not the KJV guide needs Jesus to touch their hand. Come on. Our hands need to be in service for God. Hands that'll hold a Bible and it just seems right. Hands that'll hold a choir book. Hands that'll hold a Sunday school lesson. Hands that'll hold the hand of a child in junior church. Or hold the hand of a child on a bus route. Hands that are busy serving God. Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to Thee. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of Thy love. At the impulse of Thy love. Have you ever consecrated your hands to God? Have you ever said, Jesus, touch my hands, that what I do would be what you want me to do? Jesus wants to touch your hands this morning. The touch of salvation, the touch of our hands. But let's look in Matthew chapter 9. Would you look there, please? Look in Matthew chapter 9 and verse number 29. In verse 27, in fact, we can start there. Verse 27 says, Jesus departed thence. Two blind men followed him, crying and saying, Thou son of David, have mercy on us. When he was coming to the house, the blind men came to him, and Jesus said unto them, Believe ye that I am able to do this? And they said unto him, Yea, Lord. Then touched he their eyes, saying, According to your faith be it unto you. And their eyes were opened, and Jesus straightly charged them, saying, See that no man know it. But they, when they departed, spread abroad his fame in all that country. He touched their eyes. How often does sin begin with the eye? How often does sin come through the eye gate? It way back in the Garden of Eden, the Bible says Eve saw that the tree was good and one to be desired to make one wise. Achan, when he took that which he shouldn't have taken in Jericho, remember his confession when he was found out? He said, I saw. He said, I coveted and I took. How did it all start? I saw it. It came through the eye gate. How did David sin with Bathsheba and ultimate murder of Uriah? How did all that begin? I saw her bathing on the rooftop. It came through his eye gate. No wonder David would pen later in the book of Psalms, I will set no wicked thing before mine eyes. No wonder Job said, I'll make a covenant with my eyes, that why should I look upon a maid? He said, I'm going to be careful with what comes in through my eye gate. Let me ask you a question. What do you watch on television? What do you allow to come through your eye gate? Let me ask you a question this morning. What websites do you visit on your computer? What are you allowing to come through your eye gate? You know, you can try to erase things off the computer and wipe things off the computer, but Brother Dean knows, and I think other people know, you can try to take them off there, but guess what? They're still there. You know where else they are? Right there. You cannot get them off the hard drive of your mind. It's an impossibility. Computer. Smartphone, DVDs, magazines. The problem is you look at those things and you're willing to look at anything and everything. And the problem is, hey, you've never got on your knees sometime and said, Jesus, touch my eyes. I want to give my eyes to you. Consecrate my eyes to see what you want to see. David prayed later on. You know what he prayed? Lord, open thou my eyes, that I may behold wondrous things out of thy law. Some people say, well, I just don't understand the Bible. I just read it and don't understand it. Let me ask you, have you ever prayed and said, Lord, open thou my eyes, that I may behold wondrous things out of thy law? Have you asked God to open your understanding and open your eyesight that you see the things of God? Let him touch your eyes. Jesus wants to touch you for salvation. He wants to touch your hands, what you do, and your eyes for what you see. But let's go to the next book of the New Testament, the book of Mark. And look with me at Mark 7, would you please? Mark chapter 7. Mark chapter 7. Verse number 32 says, They bring unto him one that was deaf and had an impediment in his speech, and they beseech him to put his hand upon him. And he took him aside from the multitude and put his fingers in his ears. And he spit and touched his what? Tongue. Looking up to heaven, he sighed and saith unto him, Ephphatha, that is, be opened. And straightway his ears were opened and the string of his tongue was loosed. And he spake plain. He spake plain. Oh, when Jesus touches your tongue, you speak plainly. Okay? You'll speak the way you ought to speak. Oh, for people to say what they mean and mean what they say. Now, I want you to keep this in mind and look over to James chapter 3. Would you please? James chapter 3, further to your right in the New Testament. You just keep going. You'll go past the book of Hebrews, and right after Hebrews, you'll see the book of James. And look at chapter 3 with me, will you? James 3. Are you okay this morning? All right. James chapter 3. Notice with me verse number 2. James 3 verse 2. For in many things we offend all. If any man offend not in word, the same is a perfect man, and able also to bridle the whole body. Behold, we put bits in the horses' mouths that they may obey us, and we turn about their whole body. Behold also the ships, which though they be so great and are driven of fierce winds, yet are they turned about with a very small helm, whithersoever the governor listeth. Even so the tongue is a little member, and boasteth great things. Behold, how great a matter a little fire kindleth. And the tongue is a fire, a world of, what church? Iniquity. So is the tongue among our members, that it defileth the whole body, and setteth on fire the course of nature, and it is set on fire of hell. I want you to look at verse 7 now. For every kind of beasts, and of birds, and of serpents, and of things in the sea is tamed, and hath been tamed of mankind. But the tongue can no man tame. It's an unruly evil, full of deadly poison. Therewith bless we God, even the Father, and therewith curse we men, which are made after the similitude of God. Hey, out of the same mouth proceedeth blessing and cursing. My brethren, these things ought not so to be. Doth a fountain send forth at the same place sweet water and bitter? What's the answer? No. Doesn't work that way. Saying, listen, the tongue that says that'll say sing, oh how I love Jesus at church, and then leave church and speak evil of another Christian, the one who Christ loved and died for. That's sweet water and bitter water coming out of the same fountain. Someone who sings, I love to tell the story, and then gossips about others when they get out of church. Sweet water and bitter water coming out of the same fountain. Someone who sings, how great thou art, when they're in church, and then on the Facebook page or their social media responds to something with OMG and takes the Lord's name in vain. And that is taking the Lord's name in vain. Sweet water and bitter water out of the same fountain. What are we to believe? Sweet is saying amen and hallelujah at church, and then cursing at your spouse at home. What's the problem? You never let the Lord touch your tongue. You say, well, the Bible says the tongue can no man tame. That's exactly right. You can't tame it and I can't tame it, but there is one that lives in you and lives in me that is able to tame my tongue. And that's the Lord Jesus. And if I yield my tongue to Him, if I can control that tongue, the Bible says I can control the whole body. That little bridle, that bit that goes in a horse's mouth, that big animal that's several hundred pounds, and you know what? You can control anything that animal does with that little bit that goes in his mouth. You can have the great ocean liners and the great cruise ships, and they just have a very small rudder, and that directs the course of that ship. And God says that's the way it is with that little thing that's in there. God tried to guard it between a... He put a top fence and a bottom fence right there, and they do meet each other. At least most of us do. He tries to guard that thing and keep it in there. But boy, the tongue is a world of iniquity. God says, when you want to, I want to judge. He says that you can do that. If you can allow me to control your tongue, the same as the perfect man. In other words, perfect doesn't mean you're without sin. It does mean that you're mature. That you're complete, that you're the Christian God desires you to be. That's because you control your tongue. Don't tell me how good a Christian you are. Listen, don't tell me how good a Christian you are because you read your Bible or because you go to church three times a week or because you don't do this or you don't do that. Just let me listen to your words. If you have that tongue under God's control, then you're a mature Christian. That's quiet, isn't it? We're going to let the Lord touch your tongue. Go back to the first book of the New Testament, Matthew. Matthew chapter 12. Matthew chapter 12. This is Jesus speaking. Matthew 12, notice verse number 33. Jesus said, "Either make the tree good and his fruit good, or else make the tree corrupt and his fruit corrupt, for the tree is known by his fruit. O generation of vipers, how can ye, being evil, speak good things? For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. A good man out of the good treasure of the heart bringeth forth good things. An evil man out of the evil treasure bringeth forth evil things." It said, let's go on. He says, "I say unto you, every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give account thereof in the day of judgment. For by thy words thou shalt be justified, and by thy words thou shalt be condemned." I heard recently that the average man will speak about 25,000 words a day. The average woman will speak 40,000 words a day. Now think about that. By thy words thou shalt be justified. By thy words thou shalt be condemned. There was a situation recently on the radio. Someone did an interview with some people, and what you found out was they recorded the interview and they edited the tape to make it appear like the person asked the question didn't have an answer. They doctored the tape up. You know, I'm going to tell you, God, if God's recording every word we say, we're probably going to wish in that day that somebody doctored the tape. Because I have a feeling we hear some of those words come back that we've said, we're going to cringe and say, boy, that doesn't sound good, does it? That doesn't sound right, does it? How many of you parents have experienced saying things and you never thought about it till it came out of the mouth of your child? And then you heard it and you went, is that what that sounds like when I say that? By thy words thou shalt be justified. By thy words thou shalt be condemned. No wonder Ecclesiastes, the preacher, said, remember, God's in heaven and you're upon earth. Therefore, let thy words be few. We're so quick to just fly off at our mouth because we've never let Jesus touch our tongue. We never let Jesus control our heart. And so be careful. Let the Lord touch your tongue. That song about being consecrated, the Lord said, take my lips and let them be filled with messages for thee. Take my lips and let them be filled with messages for thee. Have you ever let the Lord touch your tongue this morning? He touches us for salvation. He touches our hands. He touches our eyes. Touches our tongues. Look at Luke chapter 22, will you? You're in Matthew. Go to Mark and then Luke. Luke 22, if you would please. They're coming to arrest Jesus in the garden. And in verse 47, it says, while he yet spake, that was Jesus, behold, a multitude, and he that was called Judas, one of the 12, went before them and drew near unto Jesus to kiss him. And Jesus said unto him, Judas, betrayest thou the Son of Man with a kiss? When they which were about him saw what would follow, they said unto him, Lord, shall we smite with the sword? And one of them smote the servant of the high priest and cut off his right ear. Jesus answered and said, suffer ye thus far. And he touched his ear and healed him. It's interesting. I always thought that Jesus picked his ear up off the ground and put it back on. But that's not what that says. He cut it off and all it says, Jesus just touched his ear and it was back the way it used to be. Now, I don't know about you, but if I was in that crowd with Judas that night and I saw Jesus do that, I'd have said, let's go back home, fellas. I'm not done. I don't want to mess with this guy. Wouldn't you think? That's how blinded they were that didn't matter. Put a soldier's ear back on. But the point for our message this morning is this. Have you ever allowed Jesus to touch your ears? You know, someone who gossips, somebody who wants to talk about other people, they got to have the gossiping tongue, but you know what else a gossiping tongue has to have? It's got to have a listening ear. Got to have somebody to listen. And you're just as guilty when you listen to the gossip as when you're the one who's spreading the gossip. So what do you do when someone's telling you about something? Say, hup, stop right there. I don't want to hear that. You say, well, preacher, someone told me one time, well, pastor, if I do that, no one will ever tell me anything. That's the idea. That's the idea. I cannot tell you. I cannot begin to tell you how many problems, strife, divisions, divorces, ending of friendships have come because of the words I heard. Well, I heard so-and-so say. Well, I heard them say. Why don't you consecrate your ears to Christ? Ears that will only hear Christ's name praised, not Christ's name taken in vain. Ears that will only hear godly music and not the music of the world. Ears that will hear Christ in His church and not criticism of others. You know, hearing's so important. You got saved because of hearing. Faith comes by hearing. We're saved by grace through faith. Faith comes by hearing, hearing by the Word of God. You get saved because somebody, you heard about Jesus. And you heard what Jesus had done for you. And you understood that you needed to receive Him as your Savior. And so hearing's important. Why don't you let God touch your ears? Stop letting things come into your ears that you shouldn't listen to. And you shouldn't hear. Jesus wants to touch your life this morning. Has He touched you for salvation? Hey, He can take care of that terminal disease called sin. He can take care of that this morning. Has He touched your hands to do what's right in His sight? Has He touched your eyes to see what He says you should see? Have you allowed Him to touch your tongue so you'll speak what He wants you to speak? Have you allowed Him to touch your ears so you'll hear what He wants you to hear? All through His ministry, Jesus touched people. And it's interesting how He touched every part of them, every part of our life. Because that's what Jesus wants to do. The rest of that song says, take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to Thee. Take my moments and my days. Let them flow in ceaseless praise. Let them flow in ceaseless praise. But I think it's the last verse says, take my love, my Lord, I pour. At Thy feet its treasure store. Take myself, and I will be ever only all for Thee. Ever only all for Thee. Has that ever been... Is that always been a song you sing? Or is that a prayer that you pray? I would challenge you this morning to make it a prayer you pray. Consecrate yourself to God. Those of you heading out for Mexico this week, you ought to consecrate yourself before you even go. not just for salvation, but Lord, my eyes and my hands and my ears and my tongue and Lord, all of me, I give myself to You. Control my life. Take my life and let it be consecrated, set apart, Lord, to Thee. Let Jesus touch you, every area of your life, this morning. Heavenly Father, take the truth now today. Thank you, Lord, for touching people's lives. And thank you, Lord, you're still touching people's lives. Thank you for touching my life. Lord, thank you for touching my life as a young boy and cleansing me from sin, giving me the gift of eternal life. But I thank you, Lord, you weren't done at that point. You were only beginning. Lord, thank you that through the years you've touched my eyes and you've touched my hands. You've touched my tongue. You touched my ears. Lord, I want you to continue to touch them. That my life might be consecrated, Lord, to Thee. And I pray that would be the desire of every individual in this room. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. I'll finish the prayer in just a moment. But I wonder right now, with our heads bowed and eyes closed, and just between you and the Lord, I wonder how many folks here this morning would say, there's a time in my life, Pastor, when God touched my life for salvation. I know that He cleansed me. I know that my sins were forgiven. I know that immediately I received eternal life. I know He's touched me for salvation. Pastor, here's my hand as a testimony. Would you slip it up for a moment that I may see it? I know that I'm saved. Just hold it up there for a moment. All right, you may put it down. Is there somebody here today and would say, Pastor, I don't think I've ever had the touch of Jesus for salvation. I don't know that I have eternal life. I couldn't tell somebody for certain, with absolute certainty, that I'd go to heaven. I didn't know you could tell somebody that. My friend, would you let me pray for you? Maybe God's touching your heart this morning. You say, Pastor, I just want you to pray for me. No one's going to embarrass you or call you out. I'll simply remember to pray for you. Would you slip your hand up right now and say, Pastor, pray for me? I don't think Jesus ever touched my heart for salvation. God bless you. Thank you. The message was to believers this morning. Wonder how many believers here today would say, Preacher, the Spirit of God stopped at my seat this morning. Maybe it's your hands. Maybe it's your eyes. Maybe it's your tongue. Maybe it's your ears. I don't know what it is the Spirit of God has spoken to your heart about. But you need to allow Jesus to touch every area of your life. Nothing's off limits to Him. Maybe you need to bow your knee today and say, take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to Thee. I wonder how many believers here this morning would say, Pastor, the Lord has spoken to my heart today, and there's some areas I need to allow Jesus to touch this morning. Here's my hand, Pastor. Pray for me today. Amen. Amen. You may put them down. In a moment, we'll pray and we'll have our invitation. God has spoken to your heart. It's an opportunity for you to come and bow the knee to the Lord. Consecrate yourself to Him this morning. I tell you what, it's a wonderful, wonderful way to live. Consecrated to the Lord Jesus. Don't miss it. Don't go through life without it. Consecrate yourself to Him today. If you're here today and you've never been saved, when others are coming to pray, you come. We have people who have been trained. They'll take a Bible. They'll show you from the Bible how you can know your sins are forgiven and how you can trust Jesus as your Savior. Don't leave today without having that settled, my friend. If you're saved and you've ever been scripturally baptized, you can come and say, Pastor, I'm saved, but I need to be baptized, and you come. Whatever it is the Lord has spoken to your heart about, I want you to obey Him. Heavenly Father, we bow before you now. I thank you for decisions that have been made in the hearts of your people this morning. And I pray now in these next few moments that your will be done in every heart and life. That folks will come and bow the knee and say, Lord, take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to Thee. Take my lips, take my eyes, take my tongue, take my hands, take my ears. Lord, I want You to have all of me. May we yield ourselves to You today, and may we leave consecrated to You. Have Your way now in this invitation, please, and I'll thank You for it. With your heads bowed, stand to your feet. As you stand to your feet, our pianist will play. As she plays, Brother Bob's going to sing. As he begins to sing, God has spoken to your heart. You come this morning. That's right.
Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to Thee. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of Thy love, at the impulse of Thy love. Take my feet and let them be swift and beautiful for Thee. Take my voice and let me sing always only for my King, always only for my King. Take my lips and let them be filled with messages for Thee. Take my silver and my gold, and a mite would I withhold. Not a mite would I withhold. Take my love, my God, I pour. At Thy feet its treasure store. Take myself and I will be ever only all for Thee. Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to Thee. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of Thy love, at the impulse of Thy love. Take my feet and let them be swift and beautiful for Thee. Take my voice and let me sing always only for my King. Always only for my
Page
King.
39 in your book is what he's singing, page 39. Let's do that third and fourth verse together. It starts, take my lips and let them be filled with messages for Thee. Let's sing that together. Number 39, verse number 3, Brother Bob.
Take my lips and let them be filled with messages for Thee. Take my silver and my gold. Not a mite would I withhold. Not a mite would I withhold.
Sing the fourth verse as your prayer.
Take my love, my God, I pour. At Thy feet its treasure store. Take myself and I will be ever only all for Thee. Ever only all for Thee.
Father, we pray that this will not just be a song that we have at the end of the service, but a prayer of our heart, something that You'll keep in the foremost of our mind and our heart at all times. That, Lord, we'd always be aware that we need the touch of Jesus in our life. And I pray, Lord, that others would see that Jesus is active in our lives by what we listen to, by what we'll look at, by what we'll say and not say. Lord, that he's involved in our life and that, best of all, our sins are forgiven. Our leprosy has been cleansed and cured. Thank you for a great salvation that we have in Christ. Thank you for a great life that we have living for Jesus. And now, Lord, I pray you'll dismiss us with your care and give us a good Sunday afternoon and prepare us for the service that's yet in store for us this evening if you tarry your coming. Lord, I pray you'll continue to be with Brother Yoder and Brother Fowler as they fly in to their destination today. Give them safety, Lord, and help them to arrive safely there with Brother Moreland. Prosper their work there, Lord, in the weeks ahead. Use them to be an encouragement and a blessing and a help to the local believers there. We love you, Lord. Give us a good afternoon. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, we'll look forward to tonight. 5:30 for the Christian Growth Class, 6:30 for the service here tonight, then the fellowship afterwards, remember, and plan to stay around for that and enjoy our time together this evening, okay? Let's sing "I'm So Glad I'm a Part of the Family of God." Brother Bob? I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by his blood, joint heirs with Jesus. Thanks for coming this morning. Got a hand there? There you go. Thank you. Great to have you today. This is my wife, Kathy. That's all right. Thank you. Sure.